I started the recording. Okay, today we'll go to discuss about these topics: swagger, exception handling, and some standards about the web service endpoint. Okay. Yesterday I was saying about swagger, right? Little bit. Whenever I explained about tax controller, I was saying something about swagger. Okay. Now, what is swagger? First, we need to understand what is swagger. Swagger is a library. Using that library, we can generate a documentation for your web services. Whatever web services we are generating, we can generate document as well as we can use that swagger as a testing tool. Now, I'm using Postman, right? Now, I'm using a Postman as a testing my REST APIs. Very similarly, we can use swagger to test our REST endpoint. After the completion of development, we need to tell to the client people, hey, this is my API for saving the tax information. You have to pass this request body. You have to pass this authorization. You have to pass whatever is required. Those things we need to give properly to the client people. So based on that information, client people integrate our API. So documentation is very, very important for client people to integrate our APIs. For that purpose, Swagger is available. If you want to integrate Swagger, we have to in the POM XML file, we have to add one artifact. Swagger. This is the Swagger artifact we need to add. io.springfox boot-starter. This is the Swagger starter project. As I mentioned in the first day, if you want to add something, if you want to add any library, in the Spring Boot, we need to add starter project. We need to add a starter project. There are several starter projects. SpringFox Boot Starter is one of the projects. Using this starter project, we can integrate Swagger in our Spring Boot application. Okay, this is a version 2.0. What is the version of Spring here? This is a 2.3.3. There are, I think, before that version, prior of this version, 2.1 or 2.0, I'm not sure about that. In that particular version, we need to add two artifacts. That time, there is no Swagger starter project. We need to add two artifacts we need to add. Now we can just add this particular artifact. Once we added, all the Swagger library get downloaded in your Spring Boot application. Okay. Then, after adding this particular artifact, we need to create one class. That is a configuration class. I created Swagger configuration. In the Swagger configuration, I have added an annotation called add configuration. Whenever say add configuration, this particular class act as a configuration class. Whenever start the application, your Spring Boot application read this configuration. According to this configuration, it will generate the document. If you want to generate a document, if you want to enable a Swagger, we need to use another annotation called @enable Swagger. That's it. You are done with the Swagger. Here I will come back after some time about this. This is some small configuration. In this configuration class, we need to add one method called API method. That method should return Docker class. The Docker class related to Swagger. See? This Docker class related to Swagger. Through this API, we are initializing the Swagger documentation. Okay, Swagger documentation. Now, I'll go to start my application. This is the minimal configuration to integrate the Swagger. Okay.
Sir, can you remove that icon and stop sharing?
This one?
Can you remove that? Yes, thank you.
Thanks. The server is already started here. If you want to access Swagger UI, you need to say your application name, then swagger-ui index.html. Swagger-ui index.html. If you say like that, it will come one beautiful user interface. This is dynamically generated by Swagger library. We are not done any coding part for this. We are not done anything. By adding some configuration, by adding this particular implementation, we are saying return new docket documentation type swagger to then api info. This is the api info. The api info equals new api info. I am saying pinepad api description version 1.1. then contact detail, I am giving it's a contact detail. I'm passing object that passes coming from here. Contact detail, new contacts. Then I am saying Suresh Stalin, then URI, then what is the contact email ID. That information available inside a contact detail. That contact detail, I am passing one of the argument inside the API info class. Then this information I am passing here. Inside that API method, I am saying return new docket. I am saying documentation type Swagger 2. Then API info consumer and produce and the consume. What type of request response? I am saying here both application slash JSON. That information I am passing here. That's it. Produce also application.json, consume also application.json. So I am passing both. So once you do this, automatically this particular UI generated by our Swagger library. I am saying Pinepad API. It's a similarly, you see, whatever API I am giving here, name I am giving here, that name is coming here. Okay. Now here, see a basic error control. Forgot about this. This is coming from Spring Boot. Whatever control we created in our application, for that control coming as a one section here. For example, when in the code base, you can see here builder controller. The builder controller talk about only the billing related APIs, making payment, getting all the bills, getting particular bills, okay, getting particular payment ID, viewing the particular bill number. These are some APIs I have implemented part of builder controller. Okay, now that builder controller, all API shows here. For example, get API private bills. See API private bills that is coming here. Then, API private bills. Then here get bills method showing a get bills method. Get bills. This method does not have any parameter. Does not have any path here. So it's giving API private bills only. Okay, now this method return a one response object that will available here. See here. Whenever you say try out, if you want to invoke this API, just you can say try out. No parameter. Why? Because this particular method does not have any parameter. Okay, so it's saying the no parameter. When you say execute, what will happen now? It will not work. It says forbidden access detail because I am not passing JWT token. Here, when you see here we don't have any option to, here don't have any option to passing this token information. In the postman, right, I am passing this token, right? To pass this token information, we don't have any facility here. It says I don't have any input to copy that token information. That's the reason yesterday I was saying in the tax controller. Go to tax controller. Just copy this. Go to biller controller. Just get bills here. Just paste it. Using this annotation, you are adding one header called authorization header. Part of this endpoint, we need to pass access token. That header name is authorization. Okay, now I added. Okay. If you go to still it's not reflected, reason we need to restart the server. I'm restarting the server now. Once we restarted, In the Swagger, it will show one text box where I can enter this authorization header. Yeah, server is started now. Now I'll going to refresh this. See now API private bills, get bills. Now it's showing the authorization text box where you can enter authorization. Before that, we need to generate the authorization. From Swagger itself, we can generate the authorization. For that, which controller? It's an organization controller. Organization controller, we have, not organization controller. It's a public controller. In the public controller, we have a one endpoint called authenticate. This endpoint, we don't have to pass header. Through this endpoint only, we are going to generate the generate token. So we don't have to pass any header. We can use Swagger itself. I'll go into user public controller, authenticate, click tryout, password, refresh token. We have to pass the header information. Here, request body. I am copying from Postman. Just copy this. Just paste it here. Then where is execute. See, I got the response here. Now you can copy this header, copy this token. Go to builder controller. Click tryout. Paste this particular token. Before that, we need to pass bearer. Now try out, execute. See, we got that whatever build data available inside database, it's printing now. So if you want to test through Swagger, you need to do one changes, all the controller, wherever we need authorization, those endpoint, you need to add this particular header part, a particular header annotation, okay? Without that, you cannot test it. This is the information about the Swagger. This is a very high level information, but steps the same only. You have to add the artifact, then you need to create a configuration class. Inside a configuration class, just add this information. That's it. You are done with the Swagger. It will generate the nice user interface to test your APIs. Now, if you give this information, the client people will be happy, right? You can give this kind of information. We can just, you can copy and paste it to your client people. Use this URL, use this Swagger UI to test the REST API. Like that, we can share the information. That is the purpose of Swagger. Okay. Okay, now next, we can go to see exception handling. Spring Boot provides powerful exception handling. In generally, if you want to handle an exception, what you will do, we'll going to use try and catch, right? Try and catch. Whenever you want to catch exception, we need to throw the exception one place, then that exception will going to catch, then we need to handle it properly. That is a normal way we are doing. But Spring Boot is not like that. Spring Boot provide centralized exception handling. Spring Boot provide centralized exception handling. That is, we don't want to do try catch all the places. We don't want to do try catch all the places. We need to handle one place. In that place, take care by everywhere. Once you implemented the exception handling, we can reuse that particular thing everywhere in your application. Okay. If you want to implement Spring Boot based exception handling, we have to create one class called, that class extend from response entity exception handler. Yesterday itself I told that we need to create one class, that class extend from response entity exception handler for validation purpose also. This class used for both, for validation purpose as well as exception handling. In the exception package, you can see here duplicate key found exception, input exception, invalid token exception, resource not found exception. Okay, now we'll take one example here. Okay, now I want to catch resource not found exception. Wherever resource is not found, I want to catch that exception. For example, that could be a biller, that could be a product, that could be a customer, that could be employee, that could be a vendor. Wherever resource is not found, you are trying to search some resource in the server. If that resource is not found, I want to catch that exception in this class. So here there is one annotation called at exception handler. We need to create one method. That method should annotate it with exception handler annotation. In that particular annotation, we have to pass one class, exception class. That is, whatever exception you want to handle, that exception we need to mention here. Through this method, I want to handle resource not found exception. So I am passing here resource not found exception. Then this method return responsibility of object type. Then inside a parameter, I am passing two parameters, resource not found exception, then web request. This is a mandatory thing we need to follow. Okay. Here I am doing some logic. Here error message is my own class. When you look at this class, here you can see string error message, then local date time. Only two attribute. Very simple. Only two attribute. Only error message. This particular one minute. Someone want to join. Yeah, this particular class is having only two attribute, error message and the local date time. That is, this attribute hold what is the error, this attribute hold which time the error occurred, that information available in the local date time. I am initializing that particular Java class here. The first argument I am passing error message. Whenever resource not found exception happening across your application, this method get invoked automatically by your Spring framework. Okay, your Spring framework. Then that corresponding exception available here. I am taking message from that exception saying x.get message. That message I am passing as a first argument in error message. Then utils.get current date time. This is my method that will return current date time. Now this error message containing an error object, error information. Okay, now I want to pass this error information to client side. For that, I am saying here return new response entity of, I am passing this error message. Then I am saying one valid HTTP status code called not found. When I try to search something that is not available in the server, so I am calling this message. I am calling this method. While calling this method, the respective error message is available here. From that error, from this object, I am taking message and I am passing the current date time and assigning to the error message object. This error message object I returning as a response to the client using new responsibility passing, by passing this error message. Then I am saying resource not found status code. Okay, now we need to think. Now next question probably you have in your mind, how we are going to call this particular method, who will going to call this method. That part we'll going to see. Now I think you understand how to handle exception. We need to create one class, that class exception from this particular class. Then you need to define one method. That method should annotate it with the particular exception class that you're going to handle. Now this method is going to handle resource not found exception. Here your logic. How do you going to handle this resource not found exception? That logic I have written here. Finally, this method return error message object. That error message object will contain error message, current date and time. Okay, now we need to check how to call this particular method. Now, organization controller, there is one method called save. Whenever create organization, I want to check. I want to create only one organization. Okay, I don't want to create multiple organizations. I want to make sure that I want to create only one organization. You sorry, this is not like that. This is the duplicate key found exception. This is the wrong place. I will tell right place. 1 minute. We are talking about a resource not found, right? This is a duplicate key found exception. I'll check where we can check. Yeah. Purchase order, find my purchase order, then product. Yeah, product. So instead of whenever create a new product, whenever create a new product, I am checking that product information available inside a purchase order. I am checking here the product information available inside a purchase order. When yesterday itself I told, right, if you want to create any product, that information should available in the purchase order with registered. Then only I want to create, otherwise I don't want to create. Okay, now I'm passing some value here, vendor ID, product name and state. For this condition, I need to get a purchase order. Okay, if the purchase order is available, I'm going to populate these things. If it is not available, I'm saying resource, throw new resource not found exception. Throw new resource not found exception. Then I'm passing this message. There is no purchase order registered for vendor, vendor name, then product name for the product. I'm passing this message. Whenever throw this particular error message, your Spring Boot application, your Spring Boot framework automatically call this method. Automatically call this method. Whatever information I'm passing here, that is that. Yeah. Sorry, guys. Yeah. Whatever I'm throwing this exception, when you throw this exception, in the exception handling class, the particular method get invoked. At the time of invoking, this resource not found exception object available here. Where that resource not found exception message is available in this object. Okay. From that object, I am taking that message and passing it to error message. Then passing a current date time, I am passing this error message as a response entity to the client side. Now we'll see the demo now. The same scenario we're going to see. I'm going to start with debug mode. Okay. Run debug. I'll put breakpoint here. Okay. Then in the product management control, the save method, I'll going to put a breakpoint here. Two places I put a breakpoint. Here I am throwing the resource not found exception if purchase order is not available. Go to Postman. We need to create a product. This product we created successfully yesterday itself, right? We created a product. Now this product already available. If you try to create again the same product, it will never allow because the status changed. Status changed to completed something, some status, not a ready status. So definitely it will return a resource not found exception. Sending now. What happened? Oh, I need to, before that, I need to set access token, right? I forgot to set access token. I'm sending now. Still forbidden error. Yeah, might be that token is expired. We'll generate new token. Copy, pasting here, copy that, Okay, now I'm sending. See, the control is coming here. Since I put a breakpoint, it control come. It's coming here. When you look at your purchase order, it's a null now because purchase order is not available. Already we loaded the product, so it's giving null. Now it's now I'm throwing new reserve smartphone exception. At the time of throwing this exception, your Spring Boot exception handler, sorry, your Spring Boot framework automatically call this method. Now I'm going to release that breakpoint. It's automatically coming here. See, I'm not calling at the time of you are throwing this exception. At the time of you're throwing the exception, at the time of throwing this exception, automatically your Spring Boot calling this particular method. Okay. Now, when you look at this particular object, we have a whatever method we are passed there, that particular value is available. See here, there is no purchase order registered for the vendor one, vendor ID one, and the product name, whatever product we have entered in the request. I'll go into next. Now, this particular error object populated with the proper error message. Error message, current date and time. Now, I'll go into release the breakpoint. See that error message coming here now. There is no purchase order in registered for vendor ID and the product name. What is the current date time? Now you understand how the Spring Boot exception handling works. Just I'm not doing any try catch yet. I'm throwing. At the time of throwing, automatically your Spring Boot framework checking this exception handling or not inside the exception class. If you are handling that respective method get invoked, that error message throwing as an error response to the client side. Okay. Any questions?
Resource not found class.
Yeah, resource not found class. Tell me.
Behind it. Yes.
Yeah. This is my own exception class. That resource not found exception class coming from exception package. This is exception from runtime exception. Here is a one constructor I am passing a string error message. This constructor only I am using inside a product management service. Where is that? Here, this is, I'm passing the message in the constructor. Sorry, here, this one. Okay. So this is the way we can handle the exception in the Spring Boot. It's a generic exception. Okay. We don't have to rewrite the code again and again. Once you implemented the handling mechanism, exception, this is the handling mechanism of resource not found exception. Wherever your application, the resource not found exception throwing, all the places this method get executed. Okay. Let me check find usage.
Sir, one doubt.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, if controller advice is not there and we use at the rate value notation, will Spring take care of?
Yeah, good point. I forgot to mention that. I think yesterday I told. Yeah, we have to do that controller advice. Through this controller advice only, everything is happening. This one and this one. Two things is mandatory.
No, sir. If we don't have a controller advice in a Spring Boot application and we use valid annotation for the request parameters, so will the Spring manage that?
No, I think it's don't manage. We have to use controller advice to handle the exception.
No, not exception. I was asking about underrated valid annotation. Is there
validation? I think validation. I have not tested about that, but it should work. I think after comment out, we need to verify that. That definitely that should work. I believe.
Okay, sir.
Okay. then we need to say, then we'll go for a standards for web service endpoint. Okay. Good example is a biller controller. When you look at the biller controller, see, if you want to construct any web service endpoint, right, we need to use proper standards, okay? We should not create in our own way. For example, whenever you save any resource to the server, we need to use that resource name here. We need to use that resource name. For example, there is a do payment. Whenever call this particular endpoint, this actually saving the payment data to the database. So it's creating something. That time we are going to use post mapping. The post map, what is the things I'm going to save? I'm bills. Bill information I'm going to saving, right? So this particular endpoint will use bills. We need to use API private slash bills. That meaning we're storing bill data. That particular name must be the plural. Plural, okay. Plural means whenever you access, when instead of this postman, if you say get mapping, it will return all the bills. If you use post mapping, it will save the new bills. If you use get mapping, it will return all the bills. Okay, now I want to view one bill. That time what you have to do? API slash private bills, I want to view only one bill. From this bills nothing but plural, right? It has many number of bills. I want to view only one bill. For that, we need to pass particular bill number. So braces, then that bill number variable is a path variable. You have to pass the path variable. Through this, we can understand this endpoint return only one bill number. Through this endpoint, we can understand this will return all the bills. Through this endpoint, we can understand this bill, this particular endpoint storing some bills by providing post mapping. By providing get mapping, we can automatically understand this will return all the bills. Through this endpoint, we are understanding it's returning only one bill. Then, after bill, one bill contain multiple payments. One bill contain multiple payments. I want to view multiple all payments for that bill. For that, I am saying like this here. See here. API private bills. I want to view this bill. For that bill, I want to view all the payments. Then I'm saying here payments. That meaning for this bill, I want to view all the payments. Through this path, the client, the customer easily understand. So this particular endpoint is used for to retrieve the payments for a particular bill number. Then next one is, I want to view particular payment ID for that bill. Okay, this will return all the payments for that bill. I want to view particular payment ID for that bill. For that, the URL must be like this. API private bills, the bill number, they up to this return all the payment for this bill. Now I want to view only one payment meaning you have to pass that one payment number. So through this URL structure, we are understanding easily what is the operation of this particular endpoint. So in this way manner only we need to construct the endpoint. Okay, these are the standards we need to follow. If you look at the any company REST endpoint, they follow the standards only. Okay, understand? Whenever you give any endpoint, the endpoint must be readable. They have to understand at least some high level information through that endpoint. In such a way, we need to design the REST endpoint. Okay. Then what else next? Any question you have, please tell me. Okay. Then how many people try to deploy your local machine?
Yeah, I am doing as well.
In the chat, please tell me how many people are trying. I don't want to successfully deploy. I want how many people are trying. Please bring me.
Sir, in IntelliJ, can you show the configuration?
Tried. Nimalan, I am trying. Okay, then. Manoj, yes, I am. Only 4 people, only 5 people. Okay. Someone asked question. What is the question? Do you want to try? STS or Eclipse, something like that you are saying?
Sir, in IntelliJ, can you show the run configuration? I was not able to create. I'm using Maven Spring Boot Run. I was not able to create the run configuration.
You can go and right click run, right? That's it.
Okay, we don't need to. Okay.
Just you do this, that's it, that's enough. If you want to do configuration? When you do that, it automatically create one configuration.
332.
Hey, why? There is some background noise. What is your question?
Yeah, that was the question, sir. I was not getting that run option.
Okay, run option, sir. So if it is first time, go and try it.
Sure, sir. I'll try this. Re-import and try. So, anyways, I am using Maven Spring Boot Run.
You are imported as a Maven project?
Yeah, Maven project.
Actually, please remember that whenever you import here, file new project from existing source, then select that, then go and select this pom.xml file. You should not select folder.
We have a
Sorry? I selected the folder, maybe that is it.
Yeah, you have to select that file name. This file name is. If you select this, it will not work. You have to select this.
Okay, sir. I'll try that in next.
Yeah. Any other question? Someone is asking something, I think. Successfully, Rajini successfully done. Okay. Vivek, sir, you code for path after annotation following. What is that? Vivek? Your code for path after annotation following. I don't understand that question. Best editor is anything. I love to work with IntelliJ. It's a very fast performer. For example, the reason I'm using IntelliJ is when I work with a microservice project, there is a multiple project I'll work, multiple Spring Boot application, right? What will happen that time if you use Eclipse, I will face some performance issue, but IntelliJ, it never shows like that. Also, there is a many, there is a good user experience in the IntelliJ, but the Eclipse, I don't see such a things. If you start,
no, sir,
sorry.
Actually, the IntelliJ is paid only, or we can use free, of course.
It's a free. It's both versions available. I'm using community version. I'm not using paid one.
Okay.
If anyone has a student email ID, you can use paid also too. Any college, university email. I'm using.
Come again?
No, if anyone has university mail ID, they can get the free version also.
Oh, is it? I don't know that. But there is a community version. I used to use. Even in the company, I used to community version.
Actually, since last month I was using IntelliJ, after 1 or 2 weeks it will asking some paid.
I think you are downloaded that paid version. There is a two options.
Okay.
If you want, I'll send you the link. Community version downloadable, and there's another paid one. Two links are there.
Okay, but now for this project, I was using Eclipse only.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, most of the company is Eclipse, but once you people started working IntelliJ, you never go to Eclipse. Actually, I was working with Eclipse for the past 10 to 15 years, okay? I never used Eclipse. When I was working with PayPal, I was using IntelliJ, but most of the company I used to Eclipse only. But for the past 2 years, I'm using IntelliJ, but after start working with IntelliJ, I don't want to go to Eclipse back, because that is very good, give the good experience.
Yeah, that is it. I'm also feel like that.
Okay. Yeah, I will send him, and definitely I will send it that downloadable link in the WhatsApp group. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Vivek, it is common for understanding an actual code. Oh, do you expecting common for understanding actual code? Yeah, definitely I will do that. I will do, and tomorrow I will give the updated copy. I have done some fixes, small fixes. I have done the code, so I will add. If possible, I will add that comment. Definitely, I will add the comment and give it to you the updated code. Also, Nimalan, we have yesterday requested to give a user story for each functionality. I cannot give tomorrow, but definitely I will give by next week.
Sir, can you explain the WT flow once if possible?
Sure, I will do that, no problem. See, this, how I am generating JWT flow. First, we need to, what is the flow we need to understand? Okay, whenever request comes to the controller, before it comes to the controller, for example, let's say, we'll take simple controller, tax controller. Okay. Whenever I come to this controller, I want to validate. Even I don't want to touch this method. Okay. Before touching this method, before invoking this method, I want to validate the incoming person is valid or not. If you want to achieve that, what you have to do, we need to use filters. Filters always execute before processing request. Filter always execute before processing the request. Okay. That is a behavior of filter. We need to create a filter first. Here you can see I created one filter called JWT request filter. If you want to create a filter, we need to extend one class called one per request filter. One per request, we need to extend with this class. I have created one filter called JWT request filter, that is extend from one per request filter. In this class, we need to override one method called do filter internal. That particular method having a three attribute: request attribute, response attribute, then filter chain attribute. That three argument it has. It's a three parameter. It is having a three parameter. Okay, whenever you try to invoke one endpoint, this method get invoked first. Okay, so this is the right place to validating the JWT token. Before going to the controller, this filter get executed. To execute this filter, we need to configure. Okay, now I created, now we have implemented the filter. Later we'll go on to check this coding. Okay. Now I created a filter. Now we need to configure this filter. The security, there is a one class called security config. The security config must extend with web security configurer adapter. Okay. In this method, we need to override a method called configure method. Configure method. In this configuration method, we need to tell whatever URL is publicly accessible. Okay. What is the role? Which role can access which URL? This kind of configuration we can do in this particular configure method. That's what I have done here. When you look at here, I'm passing ant matcher, authenticate, refresh token, args, and the ping. This ping, then v2 api docs, swagger resource, swagger url. This all endpoint are publicly accessible. I mentioned like that. Auth matcher, I'm passing some path. This path publicly accessible without authenticated. Without authenticate. That's the reason we are able to access this particular authenticate endpoint. In the postman, when I say authenticate, I am passing anything here, right? Only I am passing username and password, I am invoking. Why I am able to access this particular endpoint? Because I am here I am pointing, this particular path must be accessible without authenticate, okay? Apart from this URL and path, I want to authenticate other URL. Any request I want to authenticate, that particular request must coming from employee role or super admin. Whatever request I am trying to access, apart from this, that particular, those URL must be authenticated. That logged in user must be role of employee role or super admin role. This is the configuration I am saying. Okay, then I want to call whenever authorize. I want to call one filter class. Here I'm saying these are separate configuration. Okay, URL configuration and the role configuration, everything here. After doing this, I'm adding here http.addFilters. Add filter before. I'm passing what filter you want to pop. What filter you want to call. JWT request filter auto void here. I am passing that object. Okay. I want to call this filter. Okay. Whenever anyone make a request. I want to call this filter. Let's go into the filter. This is the place where you are calling a filter. Okay. Whenever call the filter, this method get invoked. In the postman, you can see here, if I call any endpoint, I am passing header object, header data, authorization equal to this token information. That header data, this is header information. I am inside the filter method, I am getting that header data. HTTP servlet request.get header authorization, that is, I am taking this value, this entire value. I am taking here, assigning to here, this string value. Okay. Then I am checking here, it is empty, not empty. Then it's not start with mirror, those thing I am checking here. Then I am taking only this part. I am taking only this string part. Taking only this string part through this code. Then this token I am passing to one util class, JWT util class. This util class, what you will do, read this token and extract the username. Okay. What username I am passing at the time of authentication? I am passing this username, right? This method, read this token, extract this username and assign to this username. Now the username variable contain user@bmp.com. Okay. Then there is one service method, authentication service and user detail service. Through this method, it's a class. Through this class, I am calling one method called load by username. I am passing this username. Okay. This method check this username available or not in the DB. If it is available, this user detail populated. Okay. Now I got that user detail. Then here one more condition I am checking here. The token is valid or not. That is, it is already expired token or some other things there. I don't want to use that. Okay. If it is valid token, I'm coming inside this particular code. What you'll do, when you look at here, username password authentication, username password authentication token, username password authentication token, I am passing this user detail. I am passing this user detail, which I am taking from database. Okay, this is a Spring Boot API. This is not my API. This is a Spring Boot API. Okay, user password name, username password authentication token, that object name equal to user password authentication token. Then I am passing the user detail which I taken from the database. Then this is a null parameter you can pass, no problem. The third parameter I want to pass authorities. What are all the roles he is having? That role information I am passing. Everything is available here once you take it from the database. Okay, now this is validating if it is username is available, is a valid username or not. This particular API is validating. If it is valid, this line will come to this line. If it is valid, come to this line. I am setting it to our Spring Boot context. I am setting that user Spring Boot context. Okay. Otherwise, if that username is not valid, it will come to this exception block. It has come to exception block, throw the exception. This is the validation part. Okay. If it is valid user, it will come to return the it will don't throw an exception, it will authorize. That means if there is no exception, it's authorized. If this particular code is executed successfully, that meaning your user is validated successfully. If there is any problem, it will come and return bad credential exception. After that, the flow will not go anywhere to show the error. That's it. This is the way of this is the authentication part. This is the authentication mechanism I'm using here. Debug that. See, just to debug here and read the code one by one. Okay. Fairly understand?
Yes, sir. I'll debug it once.
Yeah.
So, sir, if we are going for a microservice architecture, will we have this authentication as a different microservice?
Come again?
If we go for a microservice architecture, we'll have this this authentication part as a different microservice, right?
Yes, correct. Yeah, this will be a common where we need to do that authentication. If it is okay, we need to redirect to other services. Yeah, that is correct. Okay. Any question?
So actually, I have one question. So in this billing system, are you using any Hibernate thing?
Yeah, that's what we're using JPA, right?
But in Hibernate, if you are using Hibernate, so in that there are some session object.
No, those things we no need. That is a legacy API. That is the reason Spring Boot doing everything for us. We don't have to care about those things.
Okay. Save or update, some functionality.
Sure. We can access only save or update. When you look at the repository class, right? When you go to any repository class extended from JP repository, the JP repository is having a all crude operation.
Okay.
When you look at this,
actually that Hibernate using Hibernate is using implementation of JPA, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now if you go here, the JP repository, we have all the crude operation implementation. Since you are extending this JP repository, you are able to access all the crude operation method through these repository classes. Through these repository classes, you can perform all the operation. You don't have to create additional thing, creating session, managing transaction, nothing. Okay, everything is taken care of by your Spring Boot application. Okay, you don't have to worry
about it. And so if you want to use some complex join things, then so how you have to use JPA?
Yeah, if the, in such a case, we need to write your own query. Such a case, you have to write your own query. Let's say you have a, we need to say here, at query and name equal to value equal to anything. Some query we need to write here. Then here we have to say, let's say I want to return tax find tax by name, something like that, by name, something like that. You have to say something select start from tax. This is not an exact query, just I'm saying, and where name equal to name, that's it. Then you can see here at param name, string name. So this is the syntax to write your own query.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Yeah, tomorrow I will come up with some different topics, part of billing system. Okay, I think whatever I planned, I completed already. Tomorrow I will go to give, I will check what can I contribute tomorrow. I will come up with that topics. Okay. Meanwhile, if you're facing any issue with the deploying your local machine, please ping me. Definitely I'll help you out. Any other question so far?
No.
Okay. Then we'll wind up. Okay, guys. We'll meet tomorrow. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye.